I'm Sylvain Corlet, and up until a few months ago, I was a quant researcher at Bloomberg in New York City, working on stochastic analysis and models for quant finance. But in this community, some people know me already as a member of the Jupyter team. I've been working and I'm the maintainer of the Jupyter Interactive Widgets and a bunch of visualization packages for Jupyter, like BQplot, IPyWidgets, IPyLeaflet, and Py3JS. A few months back, I relocated to Europe and I founded QuantStack, and now I'm going to talk about something that's not Jupyter, but something new, which I've been preparing for the past few months. And this is Johan, who joined QuantStack and working with me since I came back to France, and co-authored with me Extensor, and which we are going to present today. And up until he joined QuantStack, he was a quant developer and a scientific software developer at HSBC. So you know where to find us. Our GitHub and Twitter handles are Sylvain Corlet and Johan Mabillon. So you can follow us on Twitter and GitHub and see what we're up to. So before I dive into what Extensor is and how it works, I just wanted to give you some context about why we're doing what we're doing, not only because we can, but because there is the broader context to it. The three main languages of data science, so Julia, Python, and R, which gave the name Jupyter altogether, have concepts of ND arrays or data frames. They are not very interoperable. They have different semantics, incompatible memory representations. There are some standards to serialize this or communicate these through messaging protocols, but they don't really work well together. And the data frame in R is not the same thing as the data frame in Pandas, right? So we could try to make a new standard for data frames and tensors that would, you know, beat them all. But you probably all know that XKCD comics where you have a situation that where there are 14 competing standards and someone decides to make a new one to roll them all, and then you have 15 competing standards. And that's what we want to avoid here, right? So in 2015, there was a workshop in Berkeley on data structures for data science, where main important members from the R and Python and I think Julia community gathered in Berkeley at the Berkeley Institute for Data Science and discussed how they could make these ecosystems work better together and collaborate on common standards, right? And some of their conclusions is that we should try and implement common formats and protocols to communicate and store these data structures between the and to cross the language barrier more easily. Also, naturally support these languages across three languages and others like Scala and the Spark ecosystem. But mostly, since R, Python, and Julia are all based on under the hood on C and C++, or have nice C++ APIs, is to come up with a common native C++ implementation of these data structures with language bindings so that you can, without doing any copy, operate on a data frame in R and Python and have the same data frame under the hood, right? Which is going to be really important if you want to work together between R developers and Python developers. So back to the question. One tensor to rule them all, what would it look like? So the one tensor to rule them all would really need to be as cool as NumPy, so have these notions. Oh, there is some noise or issue. Should I move around or?
Yes.
Yeah.
Put the two mics, of course.
Yeah, there we go. Okay, so we really have to implement an API that is as easy to use as that of NumPy, but also you would like to enable data structures from existing tensor libraries transparently and operate in them as if they were NumPy arrays, right? And also, potentially, symbolically operate on tensors that are backed by the file system or database calls or that are only accessible through very expensive computations such as a network API. So the one tensor to rule them all cannot just be one container implementation. It doesn't work. It's just going one more standard on the side. Instead, it has to be a flexible expression system in which any data structure can be plugged, offering the most expressive and flexible API to the users. So today, I'm really glad to announce the release of Xtensor, which is, I hope, the one tensor to be the more. So what's Xtensor? First and foremost, it's a C++ template library for multi-dimensional array manipulations. It follows the idioms of the C++ STR. So you have iterator pairs to iterate on elements of tensors in multiple fashions with different orders, and which you can use the algorithms of the STL, of the standard library. But we also have an API that's similar to that of NumPy for you guys who are used to Python, for example, to be able to use them almost in the same way as you would have done in Python. But we also have Python bindings to enable extensor APIs on NumPy arrays in place. Since it's an expression system, all you need to do is write an adapter so that you can add a NumPy array and an R ND array and get an extensor expression as a return without doing any copy or any more costly operation to do this operation. And we also offer, in addition to the Tensor Python project, a cookie cutter project for authoring Python extensions so that if you want to get started and have an extension based that you can use with NumPy arrays in place and operate with the standard library or write ufunks, you can just start from our cookie cutter, ask you a few questions about the namespace that you want to use in C++, the name of the project, and it generates everything for you, from the tests to the HTML documentation and the packaging boilerplate, setup.py and everything, so that you can just push it on PyPy once you're done. And everything is open source and BSD license. So some resources before I leave it to Johan. The sources are obviously on GitHub, so quantstack, extensor, documentation and read the docs. Same for the Python bindings and the documentation of the Python bindings.
Okay, so as Sylvain pointed it out, the API of extensor and NumPy are very similar. So just a few examples so you can see it by yourself. So we can create, reshape arrays in a really similar way. We provide the views and broadcasting, filtering. Provide also reducers, so you can sum up and across direction. You can compute the mean or product of elements. Also logical functions, and of course, mathematical functions. This is not an exhaustive list because there's a lot of functions in the API of NumPy and extensor, so just you can see that the syntax is quite similar. So even if they have really a similar API, there are main differences in the ways they operate on tensors. And these differences are not only implementation details. I mean, if you understand how it works under the hood, across the middle, you can really use all the power of extensors. So we'll try with one of the main things to understand is about the lazy evaluation. So currently, when you, let's say, want to compute a formula on tensors, here, res, a variable res, is not evaluated, does not hold any value, except if you until you assign it to a container, or if you want to access an element. So that means, obviously, res is not a tensor nor an array. So what it is? Kind of magic. Actually, it's an expression. That means it's a memory representation of this syntactic tree. So we just build a graph of the expression, and we provide an API that allows us to manipulate it, just like we manipulate tensors. So back to our example. Oh.
Yeah, go ahead.
So yeah, just back to the same example.
Maybe it's too small. I think we should keep it like this.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, just a formula on tensor, what it is. In details, it's not important. So if you implement it traditionally with operator overloading and method overloadings, what you get finally when you do the computation is that bunch of temporaries, so memory allocation, dynamic memory allocation, and a lot of loops, which can be costly if you have a huge volume of data. Now with the extensor and template expression system, it's just as if you had generate one loop and computing the formula over all the elements. Of course, you can do this in C by hand, but if you want just to combine a lot of expressions, it's just not possible. So you get to use template and more advanced stuff. The same occurs when you want to access a single element of a computation. So here, I just want this element of the same computation. So traditional implementation, you compute all the temporaries just to add one element. Just not good. With extensor, you just generate the formula on the element you need. So that's about the expression system. Now that we have expression, we want to do things similar to what is done in NumPy, such as broadcasting expression, or taking view on them, or reducing them. So I start with broadcasting. So basically, the rule for broadcasting, I don't know if everybody is familiar with NumPy. Let's say we want to combine tensor and arrays with different shape. So the first one is just we have a compatible shapes. Just one is bigger than the other, so we just take the bigger one, the biggest one. We can broadcast scala. So the shape of scala broadcasted to a tensor will be the shape of the tensor. And we can also broadcast shape that are different. So that's the rule. Maybe an example will be more easy to understand. So let's say I want to add one line to a matrix. With broadcasting rule, I just add the line to every line of the matrix. So that's the result I get. What do you have now? Now about broadcasting of expression. Let's say I have that array. The memory in-memory footprint is just, these four elements. If I broadcast it in without expression system, I will, let's say the shape, two dimension, I will get 12 elements in memory. That's not optimal. So what we are doing here, just we're taking a view on the expression. We give it an API as if it was a 2D expression, but actually the in-memory footprint is the same as the underlying arrays. Of course, the same holds if we have a more complicated expression. So we don't reproduce the expression, just gives the impression it's reproduced, but it's not. Okay, for broadcasting, we have views also. So simple example, if I want to take one element out of two in each direction of a matrix, so it's a proxy. We're building a proxy on top of the array. So there are no copy. And if you update the underlying array, the view is updated and vice versa. So that means here it changes one element in the underlying array and I can see the modification reflected in the view and the opposite. We also provide lots of the other kind of view, so we can take just, let's say, one line or some of the elements, if you want, range. And the last kind of view we provide are indexing view. So let's say you have a complicated tensor and you want to select elements depending on some mapping index. You can do it with the syntax. You get a flattened view, so 1D. Now on this example, we can notice that the elements we want to select are all higher than 20. So we have a more cool syntax with a filter. So quite similar to NumPy. And of course, this filtering view is an expression. So if I just want to do some computation, I just can do it as if it was a tensor and everything is updated. Last thing we support is missing values. So I won't go into details because it's just complicated technical stuff, but just to be basic, let's say you have something like that. Well, the missing value just, how do you say that?
Sorry.
The missing value is just, whatever we've done with missing value, another value, you get a missing value. And the results and the function here as value are also expressions. So we can manipulate it, complicated, optional expression. And know where we have values and where values are missing. So now I'd like to Simon for help getting it.
Yeah, so if you want to try it out, let me try to zoom out, you can install it with Anaconda. So Conda install extensor, -c conda forge, and you'll get the package on your Anaconda distribution. There is a Debian package maintainer who is currently working on a Debian package and it's already submitted upstream should be available for Debian and apt-get within a few weeks, hopefully. And you can also just download the source on GitHub and install it with CMake, and it will just do everything as if you installed the package, if you want to get the latest of everything. But if you really don't even want to install it, and just try it now, you can go on our website, quantstack.net/extensor, and try it with a button, try it now. So I'm going to, how do I leave the full screen mode here? Weird. Well, okay. When you click on that button, try now, I think my browser is buggy. You get a C++ notebook, yes, which is interpreting C++ on the fly with a kernel that is based on the Kling C++ interpreter that is developed at CERN. And you can try it in line and see that you can pretty much do everything you do with NumPy usually in pure C++ with a syntax that's very similar to that of NumPy. So yeah, that is actually a thing, a C++ interpreter. Also, the size is not really good. You can use extensor to author, as I said earlier, to author Python extensions. So here's a quick example that actually is going to return the sum of the signs of the values of a NumPy array. So all you need to type to write this extension module in C++ is to define your sum of signs scalar function, and then define a Python module with the PyBind11 library that would import NumPy, define a function sum of sign, and return the module. And then from the Python side, all you need to do is import the generated module and call sum of sign, and you'll get the expected result. So you can very easily take your C++ library that has an API in terms of iterators and str algorithms and apply it to an NumPy array in C++ without having to do any more work. Now, if you want to write a new universal function in a native fashion, right, a function that is vectorized across all the elements of an NumPy array, it's actually possible using the NumPy C API, which is really a pain to use. Instead, what you can do is just use extensor and define your scalar function and just say, yeah, my module is going to expose only one function, which is PyVectorize of my scalar func. And there you go. You've got a function that is an actual NumPy ufunc in one line of code, which I think is unbeatable. You could go 0 lines of code, but I don't know how you would do that. And from the Python side, you can just call it as you would call any universal function on NumPy array. And finally, if you don't want to bother with all the boilerplate of having to define try to find the best practices in terms of how should I shape my GitHub repository in terms of directory structures, CMake file, and all of that for my extension module, we are going to generate all of that for you. So just check out the cookie cutter and it generates a project with your parameters like project name, namespace, and everything. And then you can start from there and tweak it. So it's pretty easy to do. So what's next? So we are already working on Julia bindings that would allow you to pass Julia arrays directly and use them as extensor expressions. There is a collaboration with Wes McKinney, the author of Pandas, on making bindings for Apache Arrow, and we're going to talk make a presentation, hopefully it's already submitted at SciPy Austin with Wes about how extensor can be used in combination with Apache Arrow. We're already working on adding SIMD acceleration, SIMD and GPU acceleration, and blast level routines in extensor. So that's something we've got experience with and we've done in multiple occasions in the past. And so to reach performances such as the ones of Eigen. And the eventual goal is world domination, but I won't, that's beyond the scope of this talk. So some credits, it's not a two people project. Beyond myself and Johan, there is a third contributor that made major contributions over the past few months. It's Wolf Olprecht, who is now at Stanford. And Also, Ghislain Anthony Vaillant is a Debian package maintainer, and he's a person currently working on the packaging of Extensor and Extensor Python for Debian. He's been doing an amazing work and helping us with the packaging and like Debian specific issues. So that's it.